And thank you, my dearly beloved, for coming tonight.
Amen.
Personally, it's such a joy for me to see you coming here.
Amen.
And the word of God will never be boring. And I was studying these lessons. I learned a great things about can be applied to our lives.
Amen.
So I hope, and tonight I'm asking you to lend your ears. And I apologize because my voice is very harsh. I hope you can still hear me. And then, before I begin, I will open a word of prayer. Dear heavenly gracious God, we thank you for this night that you gathered us once again to praise, to study, and learn to your word of God. Lord, we are asking for your presence tonight. We are asking for the Holy Spirit to be with us, to guide us, to teach us. Lord, we are asking you for to cleanse us of ourselves from uncleanliness, for the sins we committed for this day, for the past few days. We are asking you to give us a cleansed heart, an open mind, a clear mind, O God, to hear your words. And all this we pray, and this is my dream. Amen.
Amen.
We're not going to have a regular textbook tonight because along the way we're going to go through several verses of the Bible. And before I begin, I would like to tell you a story about if you're familiar about the America's great war for independence, because there was a certain soldier whose name was Benedict Arnold. This is a true story. During his life, when he was engaged in a war, then after some several years, he earned his rank to a higher position until he reached a position of becoming a brigadier general. So he started from a lowest rank going up. So there's one problem during this period of time. He has an attitude. He's very valiant person, very skillful when it comes to the art of war. Sometimes he go overhead with his ego. Sometimes he became so extravagant, egocentric. He is very concerned about focusing on himself. Ginagawa niya mga bagay just to reach his goal. He's doing a lot of things that in order to reach his own ambition. Although this is a war, but he has a personal ambition when it comes to going in a higher position. Until came when the a certain commander named General Horatio Gates relieved him of his duty. Pag sinabi kong nirelieve, he was tinanggal muna sa pwesto because for some any reason. And Benedict Arnold's anger and jealousy became worse. Kasi some other people got a higher rank and then he was suddenly been left aside. Nasa isang tabi siya, no? And then he found himself in a financial ruin, facing some court martial because along the way he did a lot of things that against the law when it comes to the art of war. So kasama na dun yung tinatawag natin Geneva Convention. He's facing a lot of trials, especially sa finances niya. His jealousy will eventually led him to betray his own country. He thinks that he can earn money when he betray his own country by going to the side of the enemy instead of his country. So what we can see here tonight, that the sin can take us farther than we wanted to go. His betrayal, his jealousy led his other people into demise. And he was portrayed as a traitor of his own country. In last week's lesson, we have this lesson of journey to Elijah, to Ella. And we saw David's anointing victory over Goliath. This is the same thing what happened to King Saul when he was overcome by his jealousy towards David. So, and we, on that time, we learned that David's anointing, and then we see the his fight against Goliath, and we heard the story last week. And I heard, and I believe that you still remember a great story. So, our lesson for tonight is named Journey to Zion. Well, Zion, by the way, is the word Jerusalem. Because we can, as of now, we can still hear in the news that the Zionist sounds like first time I heard Zion is in the movie Matrix. Zion. Then I researched, Zion is indeed the Jerusalem. So in your notes, we can see first in the life of David. David had this great trial. So David has this great trial. David's great trial during his time of his life was Saul's relentless pursuit of him. Yung muna they become a good, they have both a great, have a good start. They fought battles back, from side to side. And then in some point of their lives, King Saul has ended pursuing to kill King David. David. So ano ba nangyari right in the middle? So first, the reason for his trial. We can read in our Bible in 1 Samuel chapter 18 verse 12. And it came to pass on the morrow that the evil spirit from God came upon Saul, and he prophesied in the midst of the house, and David played with his hand. And the other times there was a javelin in hand. So, alam niyo javelin? Yung habang stick na ginabato. And Saul cast the javelin, for he said, I will smite David even out of the wall with it. And David avoided out of his presence twice. Bigla na lang yung bumibalak siyang patayin si ano, si David. Because alam ba lang ba nangyari? What happened right in the middle? We can see the reasons for the trial of David. If we're going to read in 1 Samuel chapter 18, especially in verse 7. And the women answered to one another and prayed and said, Saul had slain 1,000, and David his 10,000. Mukhang napahiyata si King Saul. Sabi siguro ng mga babae, King David, King Saul killed thousands. Gagana-gana siguro siya. Okay. But King David kills 10,000. Hindi parang, why like that? Nakikinig sa kanya. So there's a big problem there. There was a become a jealousy because along the way, David became sikat sa mata ng ibang tao. These verses give the records David increasing popularity. He became popular to the people and he was lovingly accepted among the people of Israel. And you can read that in 1 Samuel 18:16. But all Israel and Judah loved David, because he went out, came in before them. Through his many victories and battles, David became a hero in Israel. And the children of Israel sang David's praises. David was not simply gaining the favor of Israel. However, he also obtained the favor of the Lord. Because he sinusunod niya ang utos ng Panginoon. And you can see, basahin niyo na lang sa inyong time in Samuel 18:12. 1 Samuel 18:12. David's increased popularity revealed Saul's heart problem. So since nagsikat na si David, dito na lumalabas yung problema ni King Saul. He became exposed na meron siyang problema sa when it comes to the word jealousy. And jealousy gripped his heart. One of the greatest mistakes of the Christians today is that we tend to compare ourselves to other Christians. And sometimes we can see greater people when it comes to leadership in church. And this is happening, my friend. Sometimes we compare ourselves with just a church goer, then sometimes we'll be thinking that this man has come a long way. And as for me, I'm just happy to be here. Sometimes the devil will tell us, you cannot be used by God. Sometimes the devil will put some bad words in our thoughts. Sometimes we tend to compare, he is a greater teacher than me, he's a good singer than me. We tend to compare. So this is something that we should be avoiding.
Like
the second Corinthians 10:12. Sana nilatin ko sa ano. Second Corinthians, sino mas mabilis? Second Corinthians 10:12.
Second Corinthians 10:12. For we dare not make ourselves the number, or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves, and comparing themselves among themselves, are not wise.
Yes, so, yung comparison is hindi napakaganda. Just like what one of the elders told me before, that the church is a hospital for sinners. This is not a museum for saints. Huwag natin expect that all people here are perfect. Sometimes we tend to go in that direction that this man is great, I cannot be like him. But there's nothing wrong with coveting when it's come to that kind of gift, no? So isa-isa dapat natin iniiwasan yung we tend to compare ourselves. Soul problem has also been revealed. Saul's problem of fear is also revealed in his dealing with David. When Saul saw God was with David and he behaved himself wisely, thus Saul was afraid. Mapapansin natin dito that King Saul was became afraid of King David at this time. So 1 Samuel 18:12, and Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him and was departed from Saul. And this is one of the sad story to a believer. We know that King Saul is an anointed king. But to his disobedience, ano? Madami siyang ginawang pagsaway sa Panginoon. So it can happen to us, di ba? Kung pasaway tayo masyado. And we can see the favor of God. Tapunta sa ibang tao. And then you sunk into your own demise. So this is something that we should be careful about, especially for us matured Christian. So, let it be the response to trial. Because of Saul's jealousy, David had to flee. He knew it would be wrong to fight against the king whom God has chosen. So, tumakas na lang siya. Ikaw ba naman batuhin ng javelin? Sa inggit ni Saul, na siguro puminti ng tenga. Gusto niya patay si king, si David. After David fled from his presence, he eventually sought refuge in the cave of Adullam and hid there. Mababasa natin ito in 1 Samuel chapter 22, verse 1 to 2. David therefore departed thence and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brethren and his father's house heard it, they went down to tether him. So yung mga kamag-anak niya isa pumunta sa kanya. And everyone that was in distress, and everyone that was in debt, and everyone that was discontented, gathered themselves unto him, and he became a captain over them, and there were with him about 400 men. Ito na siguro yung pinakamalaking yung sinamahan yung isang tao because he was hiding. So madaming sumunod, he became a captain over them, 400. Imagine you're hiding in a cave together with 400 people. So, eventually they become discouraged in his trial. And we can see what happened to his, what happened to him. And we can read in the verse, in the chapter 1 Samuel 27, verse 1 to 2. Ito ang sabi ni David sa kanyang puso. And David said in his heart, I shall not perish one day by the hand of Saul. There is nothing better for me than I should speedily escape into the hand of Philistines, and Saul shall despair of me to seek me any more in any cause of Israel. So shall I escape out of his hand. So dito pa lang, he became pity of himself. Nag-ano na siya, he became discouraged. He believed in his heart that, he said in his heart that one day Saul will get him. So he became discouraged. Yes, he was hiding from Saul in the wilderness. And yes, he was discouraged. But he came to the point where he found his rest in the Lord. You can find his rest in his trial. After trying some time in a place called Ziklag, David encouraged himself in the Lord and God's plan for him. If we're going to read the 1 Samuel chapter 30, what happened really dito sa lugar na to? Remember the people who gathered together with him? When they came to a place called Ziklag, Siklag. Siklag. Okay? They were greatly distressed. Kasi sinakop ng mga... Basta natin sa 1 Samuel, go to your Bible. Kasi hindi ko na sinulat yan. And verse 13. And it came to pass, when David and his men were come to Siklag in the third day, the Amalekites has invaded the south and Siklag, and smitten Siklag and burned it with fire, and had taken women captives and were therein, and they slew not any, either great or small, but carried them away and went on their way. So sinakop yung lugar nila, and they were very discouraged sa nakita nila. Imagine mo, if you put yourself into a place that when you come home to your place, ay parang na ano na, mauti na. Parang ganun yung nangyari. It become a war-torn place. So, if we're going to read in verse 6, on chapter 30, verse 6, and David was greatly distressed, for his people speak of stoning him. Kasi parang sinisisi na siya, kasalanan niya ito eh. So, if we're going to read the last part of the verse, but David encouraged himself in the Lord, in the Lord his God. So if you go to underline the word encourage, ano bang ibig sabihin ng ano encourage? He put his trust. Encourage niya sa sarili niya na maniwala siya at pinasa Diyos na lang niya. This what happened to our lives also when we come to a conclusion of our life that our life became a ruin. Nawala na tayo sa ano. We have all these trials in our lives and then we found we cannot solve this. And David came to that conclusion that he's in trouble now because a lot of people nadaming na. And then he put his trust again sa Panginoon and he found his rest in trial. Dapat ganito din tayo sa Panginoon. If we come to a trial in our life, we can find rest sa Panginoon. If we're going to read in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, if we're going to read part of it, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above what you are able. So whatever trials we have, we can overcome this. Because God will not give us something that we cannot handle. So David gave his rest to the Lord. Number two, we can see David's great temptation. After King Saul was killed in the battle, so we're going fast forward in the event, we're not going to that very detail what happened kay King Saul, David became Israel's hero, and he began to reign as a king over Israel. And David was still a man's God after own heart, and he desired more than anything else to serve God. Ito lang yung pangarap ni David, is not to be a king, but to serve God. Ito yung gusto niya. The children of Israel during that time always facing in a battle. Hindi nawawala yung conflict sa Israel. Even until this date, nangyayari pa rin yung mga conflict niya to. So David led his people as he followed God and gave victory after victory to his people. It was during this time when David faced his great temptation to evil. Dito na nag-umpisa yung fall ni David. So we can see this in 2 Samuel chapter 11. We can see the lapses of King David. Ano ba yung mga lapses ni King David na banggit dito? If we're going to read the chapter 11 verse 1, and it came to pass after years was expired, at the time when kings go forth into the battle, because during that time when there's a battle, the king was always in the forefront, nasa battle siya lagi. So sinasabi dito, that David sent Joab and his servants with him, and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon, and besieged Rabbah, but David tarried still at Jerusalem. So may gera nangyari, but he chose to stay in Jerusalem. So, nag-stay na lang siya doon, ano? So, dito na nag-umpisa yung problema niya, yung temptation niya. And it came to pass in verse 2, in the evening time that David arose from his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house, and from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. And we know the story about a girl taking a bath. Her name is Bathsheba. Mm-hmm. And David said and inquired. So, let's get to this point muna, no? We can see what happening to David during this time. We can see David's lust. David saw his woman washing herself, and sin came into David's life. Alam mo, isa sa mga points dito na pwede natin matutunan, one thing that we can learn from this passage, that instead that King David was supposed to be in the battle, but he stayed in Jerusalem, that's the time he committed sin. Something what we can learn about here, if we go to church, and then we choose to stay at home, go somewhere else, nagmuling, nanood ng sine, we commit sin. Nagkakasala tayo sa Panginoon. This is something that we can learn from about this first verse. These are lapses. And sometimes we have these lapses also. We choose to own the comfort of our own house, of our own bed. So, yun yung mga nagiging problema dito. So, ito yung nangyari sa verse 3. And David sent and inquired about this woman. So, first he looked, and then he inquired. Actually, there's nothing wrong if you see a woman na medyo sexing gano'n, no? Pag ang problema na yun, lumingon ka ulit. Mm-hmm. Yun eh, kasi nakasabi natin, ay nakakita ako, nagkasala ako sa Panginoon. Hindi yun eh. Pag bumalik ang gano'n, uy, naging curious ka. Then you become, become tempted na. And then something's going on in your mind. The lust is coming into motion na. So, David not just look, but he also inquire. At hindi lang yun. In verse 4, and David sent messengers and to took her. So, hindi lang siya lumingon, hindi lang siya nag-inquire, pinakuha pa niya. Ikaw na. So, this is something, one of the greatest fall ni King David. And later on, we can learn what will happen next. This is siguro, I think, what we call that the turning point of his life when everything goes wrong from this moment on yung ginawa niyang kasalanan ito. So Christian, so isa-isa mga pwede nating matutunan dito, if we're going to read in 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 8, kinasabi dito, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil is a roaring lion walking about seeing whom may be devoured. Dearly beloved, do not be the prey of the devil. Because this can happen to everyone of us. I'm not excluding myself. I'm a guy. So, let's be careful about this one. Hindi lahat ng mga bagay na magaganda is masasama is... You know, sin comes in a very beautiful package. Because if your sins comes on a very ugly manner, you will definitely avoid it. Diba? So, ganun din yung nangyari kay David. He was astonished by this woman. Maganda siguro talaga ito si Bathsheba. No? I cannot imagine how he felt about this the trap of the devil. He became the prey of the devil himself. So, isa sa mga matututunan natin this night is that we should be avoiding the temptation sa mga bagay nito. Especially, no? Iba lang ako. Especially for us na may asawa, no? Because David has a big problem. Yung si Bathsheba naman is may asawa. Pumato siya sa may asawa, yung malaking problema. And what happened here is there's a bad chain of event that happened to his life, and we're going to tackle that later on. His pride, you can see David's pride and deceit. David attempted to hide his sin, sending a message. David commanded that Uriah to be placed in front of the battle lines when he will be surely killed. So hindi lang siya gumawa ng kasalanan, di ba? He just not commit sin, but he tried to cover his sin by sending Uriah to the forefront of the. Usually the first front of line will be killed first, and then suddenly next wave. So if you became the first part of this one, definitely you will be killed. The chances of survival is very, very low. So this is what happened to Uriah. And we can read this passage in chapter 11 of verse 2. I'm sorry, chapter 15, chapter 11, verse 15 to 17. And he wrote the letter saying, Send ye with Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle, and retire ye from him, that he may be smitten and die. So madami din ang kasalanan nito si David. When David received the message that Uriah was indeed dead, with which he assumed na talaga mamamatay siya, he married Bathsheba. We know the story, nagkagulo-gulo na. And David received the message that Uriah was indeed dead, and he married Bathsheba. But the man who was known, a man after God's own heart, now is a man who grieved God's heart. Yun yung napakasakit dito eh. After God's own heart, he grieves God's heart naman. So we can see the contrast na ginawa ni David dito. When it comes in our life, this is very violent sin. Imagine you commit adultery and then you committed a murder na pinapatay mo yung asawa. So parang sa politiko pa na nakikinig itong mga ganito na pinapatay yung asawa. But this one is something that David did. So what we can learn from this passage, I'll give you a story from I heard and I read. There was a man who's a zookeeper. You know, a raccoon. Alam niyo yung raccoon, si Rocket Raccoon. And there was a time that this zookeeper wants to tell a certain woman who wants to pet a raccoon because he's cute, diba? At sikat. This one is very popular this time, a raccoon. But she was warned that the raccoon has a, what you call this? Yung nag-iiba yung ugali, their attitude in some point after some maturity in their life, they became some weird. They intend to attack the owner without any reason. So the girl was warned not to pet this raccoon. And I told the guy that, don't worry, he will not do it to me. This one is very different. And then after some several months, this lady was rushed to the hospital for surgery because he was attacked by the raccoon. Ano bang matututunan natin? What we can learn about this one? It is the same as sin. If you pet the sin, it's okay, it will not hurt me. If you try to keep your sin, binibaby mo yan, it will not hurt me. It will just, one day, it will explode into your face that the consequences of the sin. This is one of the story in what happened to King David. He thought that this one is just a simple thing na he can hide himself. He thought that he can manage the sin, will not expose him. So what happens next is David's losses. We can see that David's losses against this dilemma. David suffered a great and personal losses because of his sin. And the greatest loss was of that is the fellowship from God. When we commit sin, we know this to be true, that we lost our fellowship with God. It is true. It's hard to have a fellowship with God when you committed a sin. Unless you confess that and you ask for forgiveness sa Panginoon. It's hard to have fellowship with God when you're doing some continual sinning. It's really hard to fellowship din doon sa mga brethren natin. If you're hiding some sin in your life, and confess him. David also suffered severe consequences in his family life. Notice the tragic events that came as a result of David's sin. Ano yung unang naging tragic event sa kanyang buhay? We can see that in 2 Samuel chapter 12 verse 14. Sabi ni Nathan dito, Howbeit, because by the deed that thou hast given great occasion of the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. Mm-hmm. Yung anak niya kay
Bathsheba.
So ang nagsasuffer dito, yung anak. This is something we can learn something about also. If we commit sin, sometimes we think, I can endure the consequences. I can endure. But in this story, let us be reminded that sometimes the consequences of our sin can be harm to our loved ones. They will suffer the sins or the consequences of our sin. If we made some wrong choices here, and then we do some crazy stuff here in Qatar, we commit a lot of, if we have wife, then we committed adultery, sino magsasuffer? The consequences will be your family back in Philippines. This is something what happened to King David. Ang naging kabayaran ng kasalanan niya was his offspring. At hindi lang nagtapos doon. What happened next is that his son, Amon, anong ginawa niya sa kanyang kapatid? He raped her. Kapatid niya, imagine. For this time, that's very gruesome thing. Diba? If I'm looking to my sister, one and only sister, I cannot do such a thing. But Amnon did this to sa kanyang kapatid. At hindi lang yun. What happened to Amon? To Amnon? Oh, pinatay din naman siya ni Absalom. Then what happened to Absalom? Was killed by Joab. And then Amsa, David's nephew, was killed by Joab also. So ano na nagkaano na? Nagka-sunod-sunod na yung chain reaction ng kasalanan, ng consequences ng kasalanan niya. So this is something that we should be reminded of. If we can endure the consequences of the sin, let's be reminded that the consequences of the sin of our sin can be directed to our loved ones also. So this is to be true. This is a warning for all of us and a reminder to all of us. Along our journey of our faith, we will have trials and temptation. Both are inevitable, mga hindi maiwasan. To continue in advancing our journey of faith, we must respond by fleeing the temptation and trusting God during the times of trial. So that's something that we learned about the consequences of David's sin. And lastly, David's triumph. Though David suffered immensely because of his sin, he was able to experience the triumph once again. Ito yung good news na, no? And it starts in 2 Samuel chapter 12. Dito yung dumating si Nathan. The last one that we just discussed is part of this one. When Nathan told that his offspring will surely die. Ito na yung umpisa nun. And God sent Prophet Nathan to expose David's sin by recounting an illustration of two men. The first owned a little lamb and the other possessed many sheep. And Nathan confronted King David. Punta tayo sa 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 1 to 6. Basahin na lang natin ito. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city, the rich one and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing, save one little ewe lamb which he had bought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him. If you can see the picture of him, meron dalawang tao. Isang rich man, madaming flock. At yung isa naman is nag-iisa na lang. Halos sa pinalaki na nito as considered the lamb, his own. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take his own flock of his own herd to dress up for the wayfaring men. And there was a come unto him that took the poor man's lamb. Kinuha niya yung nag-iisang tupa. And then when David's anger was greatly kindled against this man, and he said, Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this thing shall surely die, and he shall restore the lamb fourfold, because he did this thing, and because he had no pity. Ito na yung pinaka-climax. Siguro medyo dramatic yung nangyari ito. Kasi nagagalit si King David. In verse 7, and Nathan said to David, thou art the man. I can hardly imagine what's the expression in his face when his sin was suddenly exploded into his face. I don't know, maybe nanlumo siya or something like that. And the next verses here tell Nathan na what are the things that God did to his life. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel. I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul, and I give thee my master's house and thy master's wives in thy bosom, and give thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that has been too little, kung maliit pa ba yung, I would moreover be given unto thee such and such things. Ang dami ng binigay ng Panginoon sa kanila, sa kanya. Kumbaga ba, pangalap ko lang ang papa ba? To take this, commit adultery with Bathsheba, na kinuha niya. This is the story here. What happened next is that, we can see the confession of King David in letter B. In 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 13 to 14, and David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin, thou shalt not die. Hindi ka mamamatay. How be it? Because by the deed thou hast given great occasion of the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. The child also is born unto thee shall surely die. Ito yung pinag-usapan natin kanina. What Nathan told him is that you give occasion for the enemies to blaspheme God. What we can learn about this, what Nathan tells us here is that when we commit sin, we give others, non-believer, to blaspheme and to mock God. I would always remind other believers that we are always under watch of non-believers. Naghahantay lang sila sa atin na we fall into a great sin. And then they will say that, are these Christians, look what they did, So they, what we can hear is something true. Then when we fall to temptation at napahiya tayo and we have sins are exposed, our testimony of being Christian is destroyed. And that's the time that the other non-believers will mock God. That's what you call believers. So that is something that we can learn here. Nathan exposed King David's sin and called for David's repentance. With his broken heart, David confessed, repent, and sought God's restoration, penning his thoughts in Psalms chapter 51. And we can read this in chapter 51, verse 3 to 4 of Psalms. For I acknowledge my transgression, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only, I have sinned, and I've done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and declare when thou judgest. So, ano ginawa ni King David dito? He was greatly, broken. He confessed. He repented. That's why, in letter C, we can see a restored kingdom. God preserved David's life and continued his kingdom. In 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 1 to 4, and David spake unto the Lord in the words of the songs in the day that the Lord had delivered him out of the hand of his enemies, out of the hand of Saul. And he said, the Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer. The God of my rock, in him I will trust. He is my shield, and he is horn of my salvation, my high tower, my high refuge, my Savior, thou savest me from violence. I will call unto the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, who shall be forever my enemies. What we can learn in this last passage, in this last point of our study tonight, no sin is beyond God's redemption. Even though gano'n napakabigat ang kasalanan na gawa mo, hanggang buhay tayo, there's always a mercy coming from God. This is something that we should also Christian exercise to the fellow believers or loved ones who sins against us. I did not say that forgiveness is an easy thing, especially if you've been hurt. But by the grace of God, you can do such a thing to forgive other people who hurt you. And that's the only thing that you can heal. That we need to pray for one another so you can be healed. Yung sasabi ng Panginoon.